each other and said, hey, they seem extremely ready to play. As you look at Butterfield and Shaw, this one is underway. From the two-yard line, it's Butterfield. 10, 15, breaks it across the 25. Still on his feet, and he's got one man to beat. Gets by the kicker and is tripped up, actually, by the kicker, William Watts. And there was a flag down back at the 33. So holding signaled against Michigan. Let's take a look at the starters. Little bit of a surprise. Not really if you saw him against Ohio State. Brian Greasy gets the start. He will have Chris Floyd and Clarence Williams. We'll also see a lot of Chris Howard today in the backfield. The wide receivers, Ty Streets. Outstanding game against Ohio State. Had the three catches, the big touchdown. Also, Russell Shaw, number four, the flanker. The tight end is Jeremy Tooman. Up front, a very big and active offensive line. Wines, Denson, Payne, his 40th start as a Michigan Wolverine as he comes out over the football. Senior out of Miami, Florida, 6'4", 289. Greasy sets the throw and first down. Flushed out of the pocket, and he's going to be tackled after one by Paul Pickett. Take a look at the starters for the Alabama Crimson Tide. The down four, we talked about active people, particularly Myers, number 96. You'll see him, and also 78, Ozell Powell, doubled a lot today. The linebackers, they may be as quick as any group in the country, particularly Dwayne Rudd and Ralph Staten. And in the secondary, Deshaid Townsend has been bothered by a hamstring, seems to be rather healthy now. Kevin Jackson, an All-American at safety. Running play, five. At 10, Samuel makes the tackle on Chris Howard, and I mentioned we'll see Clarence Williams and Chris Howard in this football game today.
Well, you have to do a good job on Michael Myers if you're going to run the football for the Michigan Wolverines. Michael Myers, number 96, getting blocked in there. Good job at Damon Denson, the offensive guard, to get a little bit of room for the running game.
It's a gain of eight as they have spotted him down at the 30-yard line. So third down, and they need three to pick up the first down. It's Clarence Williams in motion. Linebackers on the blitz. Ball is thrown and is dropped because Russell Shaw got taken away from the football by Samuel. Deshaid Townsend coming over as well to make the hit, and it will be punting time for the Michigan Wolverines.
Well, it's a good hit by Deshaid Townsend, Ron, to jar that ball loose from Russell Shaw, the junior college receiver.
Paul Parasaris, a senior out of Lincoln Park, Michigan, will kick it away. Goss is the deep man, waiting back at the 27. Pressure up the middle, gets it away. Short kick, Goss runs away from it, very short, and now takes a huge Alabama bounce back inside the 30-yard line, and Mike, he's going to wind up with a negative yardage on the punt.
Well, first of all, Ron, they were very fortunate it wasn't blocked because Alabama was able to spring someone free to block that kick. See the effort by the Alabama defense. Tim Bowens, number 8, will get through. Should have a good shot of blocking the football. Just had his hands too high, and that caused the bad kick.
Mikey gets a minus 2 yards on the kick. So the Alabama Crimson Tide takes it over at the Michigan 28.
Well, we talked about defense setting the offense up, and the Alabama defense has set their offense right now.
Kitchens pumps, gets it out in the flat, throws the safety. 25 down to the 23-yard line as Huff will come over to make the stop on the play. And here are the starters. Kitchens at quarterback. Riddle, who you just saw, along with Travis Smith. The wide receivers, 22 Vaughn is the go-to guy. And the offensive line, and Mike, I think this may be a problem area for Alabama today if they have one. Pennington, Causey, a co-captain. Laron White, along with Pete DeMario up front. Jeremy Pennington, 79, gets the start at left guard. Wilfrin out with a knee injury. Running play, going nowhere. In fact, backwards. Copenhaver, one of the linebackers, comes up to make the hit. And here are the starters for Michigan on defense. Huff, William Carr, as Mike said, he told us, hey, I'm going to prove my point. I'm going to be the best defensive lineman on the field on game day. The linebackers, Jared Irons. It all starts with him. He's the heart and soul of this Michigan defense. And in the secondary, this is a very good group, particularly Charles Woodson. They play him some on offense as well as on defense. Outstanding athlete. That's a loss of one by Alabama. So it's third down. Line to make is the 18. Kitchens, safety valve again. Alexander hit and knocked down after a loss of three, and it's Jared Irons who comes over to make the play for Michigan, and again, defense steps up big.
Well, it's very important when you have a turnover like they did, even though it was not a turnover, a bad punt, that your defense respond. Jared Irons, who started 45 games for Michigan, he's their leading linebacker, made the play and is going to force this field goal.
John Brock to attempt the field goal, and this one will come from the 34, the far hash mark. So a 44-yard attempt as Alabama tries to go on top early. Good pass. Kick is on the way. Plenty of distance, and he got it. John Brock, 44 yards in the field goal. Alabama, 3-0. We'll be right back. When Alabama's receivers, conversely, will be looking back into it. Until about an hour, hour and a half from now, it can be a difficult situation. William Watts kicks it off for Alabama. Butterfield obviously will not run it out. Mike, are you surprised by the start of Greasy in the ballgame?
No, I think they had a real choice, but I think because Brian Greasy played a great ball game against Ohio State, the coaches set a perfect game, and he picked up practice right where he left off the Ohio State game. So he earned the right to start this football game.
I asked him yesterday at the walkthrough, I said, do you want me to give your dad a message on the air? And he said, he's probably in a production meeting. He said, tell Mr. Goodrich to let him out. Of course, he had Keith preparing for the Sugar Bowl game on Thursday evening. Running play, stuffed in the backfield. There's nothing there for Chris Howard. Ralph Staton is the man who came through to just mess up everything. Tyrell Buckner also there to make the stop.
Well, when you look at both these defenses, it's tough to run against both Michigan and Alabama. Alabama's only given up 2.8 yards per rushing attempt. Ralph Staton, number 41, just steps into the hole, gets a little penetration. Chris Howard brings him down.
One of the things that Coach Carr said yesterday that really concerns him and his staff is just what we've been seeing. He said this is the fastest group of linebackers that they have been confronted with.
A little quicker defense, a lot like Ohio State's defense, Michigan's coaches feel.
From the shotgun, right over the middle, throws it complete. He's got Williams, open field, 25, and run out of bounds at the 27, and that's Kevin Jackson who pushed him out. And Rod Payne, well, maybe just got a shoe stepped on. He did. I thought for a moment there that the veteran center was injured, but someone stepped on the back of his shoe.
Ron, Stan Parrish, the quarterback coach, when he's talking about Brian Greasy, he said when he arrived in Michigan, he was the third-team quarterback. But he kept himself ready, prepared always very well. He has great confidence, and he has the ability in a ball game mentally to upgrade it a notch. And he's going to have to make some big decisions in this ball game because of dumping passes off, because Alabama's a very, very strong blitzing football team.
Third down, and if they want to keep this one going, they've got to take it across the 30-yard line. And now a timeout called by Michigan. So we'll take the break with them. 3-0. Alabama leads at the 10th. 3-0, Alabama leads. And Mike, what does Michigan have to do?
Well, first of all, I think their game plan is as early as excellent, but they have to get used to the speed of the Alabama defense. Their practice teams cannot simulate the speed of this Alabama defense.
Russell and Streets come out wide to the right side. Greasy sets to throw, looking, gets it out here to Shaw, and he crosses the 30 and is going to have the Michigan first down. Ralph Staton makes the tackle. Mike, we talked about the great game that Brian Gracie had against Ohio State. This was a 9-0 ball game with this happen right here.
Brian Greasy's an excellent quarterback. You see, it's a three-step drop, and you see the result. It's a touchdown, big touchdown pass against Ohio State. They're doing the same thing here early against Alabama, figuring Alabama's going to blitz. Three-step drop by Brian Greasy. Get rid of the ball quick.
That was good for a 68-yard touchdown to tie Streets. Right now, the Wolverines, just having picked up their first down, they go straight ahead with the run. It's going to go for 3 yards. And that's about it. Kevin Jackson up from the secondary. And you could see Rudd, the linebacker, coming through again on the blitz.
When you look at the big Michigan offensive line, if you're sitting at home right now, you're probably thinking the same thing. Big offensive line of Michigan, averaging 291 pounds against the quickness of Alabama in the Southeastern Conference. Like a heavyweight fighter, they would like to wear out Alabama in the fourth quarter. Lean on them for four quarters.
Well, two wide receivers to the top of your screen. You can see Shaw in motion with a counter tray. And it's going to go for 4 yards as Rudd will step up and hit Howard and knock him down at the 43. So, again, a third down and about 2.5 to 3 yards for the Michigan Wolverines.
Well, Dwayne Rudd is the kind of linebacker, if you run at him, number 87, he's very difficult to block because he's got good pad-under-pad techniques. He makes the tackle right here. And then also, if you run away from him, he has such great speed that he can track you down. Good job by the Michigan offensive line opening that hole.
Tooman, the tight end, flips from the right over to the left. Line to make, the 46. Greasy gets his pass away, and nice catch at the 45. It's not going to be enough for the first down. Fernando Bryant was right there to make the hit on Streets as soon as he caught the football. I'm surprised he held on.
Ron, I tell you what Michigan's trying to do here early is because Alabama blitzes and really plays a lot of man coverage, they're trying to show a lot of formations to Alabama to try to talk them out of those blitzes.
Well, let's see what happens. Peristeris got rushed so hard last time, he had a -2 on his punt. Think Bam will come after him again?
No, I don't think so at this field position. I think they're concerned about the fourth and short, so they'll be in a punt safe.
Deshae Townsend, number two, back in a single safety, and you're exactly right. They got the return on. Fair catch is called for and made by Townsend at the 19. State and number three, Florida. 8 minutes exactly left to play in this opening quarter. Alabama 3-0 on the strength of a 43-yard field goal. Alabama keeps it on the ground, running across the 20 as Sam Sword will step up into the pocket and make the tackle.
Marcus Ray, the safety, number 29, really was sneaking up on the play before the play started, trying to get that extra 8th and 9th man against this Alabama running attack.
Marcus needs a couple of tackles in this ball game today to become one of those members of the Wolverines that has 100-plus tackles for the season. Makes it to Riddle. Pressure from behind. Now Kitchens running for his life, and he's going to be tackled. And the man who made the tackle is Steele, and you can see he made it without his headgear.
Run. Freddie Kitchens really doesn't have a lot of movement to be able to get away from the rush. So when you get penetration like that against the offensive line, you're usually going to sack Freddie Kitchens. But I want to go back to his last two games. Freddie Kitchens, now he didn't put the ball up here for an interception. He wisely pulled it down. And against Auburn in Florida, he made good decisions in that football game. Auburn, he took what the defense gave him and resulted in a win for Alabama.
You can see Glenn Steele, the junior out of Ligonier, Indiana. What an effort. He was going to come and make the tackle, headgear or no. Kind of hard on the ears. Kitchens right over the middle, has it complete. Crosses the 30-yard line, still loose is Vaughn, and they'll knock him out of bounds at the 34-yard line. Kind of disappeared into the crowd of Michigan players right there on the sideline. Tommy Hendricks, the freshman out of Houston, pushed him out.
Well, this is the big play receiver for Alabama. Michael Vaughn is their receiving threat. He had 39 catches, 6 touchdowns. Didn't catch a pass in 1995, but has emerged as their best pass receiver. And Charles Woodson, when we were talking to him, the defensive back the other day, he said what concerns us most about Michael Vaughn is the yards after the catch. And hey, you see that.
Trust me.
against Florida in the SEC championship game. He had a 94-yarder, just bam, and he was gone. So he is capable of the big play. That's good for 14. Kitchens swings it out on the flat, got Alexander. Curtis tries to turn the corner, going to go for 4, now 5 yards. Marcus Ray knocks him down, and let's check in with Kellen Winslow. Kellen?
Ron, yesterday in our meeting with Coach Woody McCorvey, the offensive coordinator for Alabama, he said the one thing that he's liked about Freddie Kitchens is that he's starting to throw the ball to the backs more, which is what he wants him to do. Look downfield, it's not there, turn around, get the ball to the back. It's just like a running play at that point stage, as he just did.
And I think the key also, Ron, is for the first time this year, other than the start of the season, Freddie Kitchens is healthy. He went through a shoulder problem, a knee problem, a
ribs
foot problem,
too.
Ribs. He's healthy now. Getting a little more velocity on the football.
You see number 96. That's William Carr. Running play to go straight at him. And here's Riddle. Breaks it open at midfield and down to the Michigan 45-yard line. And it was William Carr who had a shot at him, but he couldn't hold on. And it's good for 15.
Well, they had good penetration. Michigan will. William Carr, number 96, is going to get into the backfield, but he's at a good block back there. And now all of a sudden, Dennis Riddle gets by all the penetration up in the inside. There's a couple arm tackles. Now he's into the secondary.
Curtis Alexander back in the ballgame. And you know Alabama has a stable of tailbacks. And on this warm day, that may prove to be really big, having fresh legs in the ballgame.
Well, isn't it interesting that Sean Alexander, probably the third guy, had a field day against LSU?
All time in the history of Alabama rushing. Swings it out to Curtis. Great job by Michigan. He'll wind up with 1, maybe 2 yards as Marcus Ray comes over to make the hit along with Taylor.
What this type of play will do is it's a running play. It will slow down the pass rush. You're going to see William Carr again, number 96, being doubled by the center and the guard. Pretty good job by LaRon White. Now the ball is thrown out to the outside. It's like a run. Now you make the defensive players from Michigan break down and make a clean tackle.
So it's second down, and Michigan again accomplishes what it wants to, and that is making Alabama play with a second and long situation rather than second and short. Kitchens 5 of 5 to open this ball game. Back to Riddle. Gets the block, turns the corner, and cannot get by Charles Woodson. That is an outstanding open field grab. If he doesn't get him, Riddle's got a lot of running room down the sideline.
Well, Charles Woodson is an outstanding player. Started as a freshman at the University of Michigan, was freshman of the year in the Big Ten. And because he has an air of confidence about him, that was the reason he started for this Michigan Wolverine team. And he comes up. Now he has to make a sure tackle against Dennis Riddle on the outside. You see him tackling low.
Interesting, even watching in slow motion, the way both those guys glide. Great athletes out there, one-on-one. Third down, and Alabama needs the 35 of Michigan. Right over the middle, has it complete. Not going to be enough for the tight end. A sword will make the tackle, and Calvin Hall, the sophomore out of Gallatin, Tennessee. And it's going to be punting time for the Alabama Crimson Tide.
Yeah, I think they'll now try to punt Michigan's offense in the hole and play like they played all year. Play defense, turn it over to their kicking game, and see if they can keep Michigan pinned in there and win this field position battle early.
Hayden Stockton to pooch kick here. Boy, the night we had Alabama against LSU, he simply was a weapon that helped them win the football game.
Without a doubt, he won the field position battle that night.
Kicks it for the far sideline away from Woodson. And miss it. Goes into the end zone. So it's a 39-yard kick. 3 minutes, 28 seconds left. Opening quarter. Crimson Tide, 3-0. The Blockbuster Blimp and its crew in today's event. Piloting the Blockbuster Blimp today is Captain Terry Dillard from Orlando, Florida. Great to have you guys with us today, and I know that you're glad you're flying today and not the first day of 1996. I don't think that thing would have flown us last year. I think maybe waterlogged would have been more like it. Outstanding game, just as we thought we would see. A defensive struggle in this opening quarter as we've just hit the 3:28 mark of the opening period. Again, Michigan spreads them out. Quick pass right over the middle, and they've got it to Charles Woodson. And Woodson will take it to the 32, the 33. Cedric Samuel makes the stop on him. And wow, when he touches the football, you know something can happen quick.
Well, an interesting statement one of the Michigan coaches told me. He said, you know, Anthony Carter was the greatest athlete since he's been there to wear a Michigan uniform. until Charles Woodson arrived. Now, Charles Woodson was a tailback in high school. Gained over 2,028 yards at Fremont Ross in Fremont, Ohio.
Two wide receivers left. Here comes the counter play, and I'll tell you what, Chris Howard just tripped over the grass. He went down trying to make his cut. You can see Denson. Damon Denson was out front getting ready to block for him, along with John Jansen, and he lost his footing. So it's a loss of one, second down and 11. Let me ask you this about Woodson. I know they like to use him going both ways. As it gets hotter over the course of this day, are they going to have to back off a little bit?
I don't think so, Ron. I think with the 85 scholarship limit, you're going to see more and more players playing both ways around the country.
If you got a good guy,
you might as well put him on the field.
Counter play. Hit at the line of scrimmage, and there's nothing for Chris Howard. Absolutely nothing. That's Rudd and Cedric Samuel, and a flag has been thrown right into the pile, and I think it came from the umpire. That's not a good sign for Michigan.
Ron, I'll tell you what's going to be the most important thing for Michigan's offense in this football game is Lloyd Carr is showing his displeasure. But the key for Michigan will be their matchup. When you play a blitzing team that plays a lot of man coverage, you must win the battle of the wide receivers versus the two corners. So Streets, 86, Russell Shaw, 4. They're not going to win this football game running the football. Eventually, that will be the style they want to play. But they have to beat Deshae Townsend and Fernando Bryant, because you're going to get a lot of man coverage, a lot of lock-on with Deshae Townsend, and you have to win that battle if you're going to beat Alabama. They didn't beat the battle last year when they played A&M in the Alamo Bowl. If you remember that, A&M
right.
Blitzed them, played man coverage against them, shut Michigan's passing game down. And if they allow that to happen again today, they're going to get beat again.
So the penalty stepped off, and it's all the way back to the 24. Second down. About 23, 24 yards. Greasy again. Quick pass over the middle. Got to complete to Clarence Williams. He's free. And look who comes from out of nowhere. That's a linebacker, Ralph Staton, and he'll catch him from behind.
A good call by Fred Jackson, the offensive coordinator, because you're worried about the blitz of Alabama. All of a sudden, they bring all the defensive backs on the field, and you shift your tailback out just before the snap of the ball and get him against the linebacker, strong safety tight, and then Brian Greasy just delivers the quick screen, the middle screen, to Clarence Williams. Now you see all the good blocking by Michigan downfield. That's Damon Denson, 51, his first down.
45 yards in the pass play, so they overcome the big holding call. Counter play, hit in the backfield. I mean, there's nothing for Clarence Williams. Michael Myers this time. Mike, I want to go back to the last play. Not a defensive back, but Ralph Staton, who was a free safety in high school, he ran him down and almost ran over him.
Well, that's the great effort you look out of championship defenses, because you always tell the defense you do not quit on a play, because you never know by an angle. If you take the right angle, you can make the play, save the touchdown, or save the field goal attempt. A great play by Ralph Staton.
Chris Howard comes back into the ballgame, as well as Russell Shaw. Both teams substituting freely with the wide receivers and the running backs. Shaw coming out, moved out at the bottom of your screen. Whistle, and they may not have gotten this one off.
Run out. Michigan.
The lead game, offense, 5-yard penalty, second down.
Is confusing Alabama with some shifts right before the snap of the ball. Now, they hit that quick middle screen to Clarence Williams a play ago, but then they come back out and they shift Russell Shaw, number 4, out of the backfield. Now, all of a sudden, here's two Alabama players coming over, not sure who's going to cover him. So they've got Alabama a little confused on defense.
Chris Floyd checks back into the lineup, number 7. Junior out of Detroit. Second down, and Michigan needs the 22.5 of Alabama. Fake the counter, pressure on Greasy, got him wide open at the 35 and down to the 30. Sickler will come over to make the stop on Chris Floyd, and that could have been the final play of the first quarter.
When you ask a quarterback to throw that route, you ask him to throw it under tremendous pressure. Chris Hood, 34, Kelvin Moore, 95, right in the face of Brian Greasy, but he made that play.
Mike, we didn't see it because of all the color in the middle of the field. There was a flag.
It may be roughing the passer. or could be holding because Michigan was real close on that, but a lot of pressure on Brian Greasy from Hood and Moore. What a great effort by Brian Greasy in the face of that defensive pressure to throw that football.
Yep, they were all over him, and it does look like it's going to be face mask call against Alabama as Rod Payne comes over and is trying to discuss with the sideline what the options are.
But what you try to do as a coach, you want to get the information as quick as you can to try to decide what you want to do and get it out to your captain. And they're doing a pretty good job here. Officials come over to explain it to Lloyd Carr.
It obviously is the 5-yard variety, but with the 15, it would be, we would have already taken that and the 5-yard, first down.
5-yard, mm-hmm. Face mask, finish from the previous spot, 5 yards, repeat second down.
So they will repeat second down, and it's going to be a second down and 12.
That's an interesting decision there because you back it up, and now you're second and 12, whereas probably could have been third and 7 or third and 6. So an interesting decision, trying to take the down to make use of the down. Let's see how it works.
You see Chris Hood, the sophomore out of Town Creek, lined up at that left defensive end spot. Williams in motion as Greasy sets in the pocket right over the middle. It is complete to Williams, and Fernando Bryant has him in his grasp at the line of scrimmage. It'll be third down, Michigan. And that is the end of the first quarter. So let's take a timeout. Alabama 3, Michigan nothing. 15 minutes, Alabama 3-0. It was a 43-yard field goal, and here are the numbers on that first 15 minutes. Anything stick out at you, Mike?
Yeah, I think the big thing, Ron, is when you look at both those stats there, 17 yards for Alabama running the football, Michigan only 6 in time of possession, Alabama 6:39, Michigan 8:21. So defenses controlled the first quarter.
No upset there. Third down, and they need to take the ball to the 22-and-a-half-yard line to keep this thing going. Greasy, play action, going to go long, and he's got Williams at the 5, incomplete. Dwayne Rudd was covering him step for step. And you know one of the things that is confusing and crowds get upset about is the rule in college and the rule in pro are different. That's not face masking anymore.
Ron, here's what Michigan decided to do. Go to two tight ends to get blocking. So they'll block this tight end right here to give some time for Brian Greasy to throw. Even though they blocked it, Brian Greasy steps up. Now here's the throw to Clarence Williams against Dwayne Rudd. Clarence Williams trying to, I don't know, Ron, he didn't give him a line, a chance to come back and catch that football.
Brian Greasy is the pooch punter, and here's his kick. Very high, not real long, but that's the purpose. And a fair catch signal for by Townsend and made just inside the 15. So we'll hold it right here with 14:36 left until halftime. Do you have
Emma down here? Not allow them out of this hole. Get their offense good field position.
Alexander, Curtis gets to the outside, 20, 25, and out to the 30-yard line. And Curtis Alexander, who was the starting tailback at the beginning of the year, suffered a wrist injury, had to have minor surgery, missed 4 games. He's back.
Well, this is a stretch play, a zone play, where you just get your lineman into the Michigan defense, and then you just let the tailback, Sean Alexander, just find a hole and try to get into the secondary, and he did that.
Sean Alexander in, who had the great night against LSU. He gets the handoff, nothing to the left, so he'll cut it back up the middle, and he will have a couple of yards. Mike, let's go back and look at one play. Michigan wound up with no points following that 45-yard middle screen.
Every coach, whether it's midget league or junior high school or the pros, they always tell the players, you go. You continue to go until the whistle blows. Ralph Staten didn't stop, and he was able to track down Clarence Williams, and that saved that scoring opportunity. You're going to see him come out of nowhere, number 41. He didn't stop. He didn't buy a ticket, count his change in his pocket.
He saved a touchdown. To play. Saved a touchdown for his football team. Ed Sism, who was back, is in at fullback as Curtis Checkett, Sean Alexander, defender straight ahead, and Glenn Steele, who has already had an outstanding first half, trips him up.
No, Ron, it looks like in Alabama's scheme of things, what they're trying to do passing-wise, again, they know it's going to be difficult to run. They're trying to get their backs involved in the passing game. And another weapon that they have is Patrick Cape, who I think is a really a solid tight end that not a lot of people know about. Number 38, he has great hands when you watch him practice catching the football.
So the question for Alabama today is Gene Stallings are going to line up and take it straight at him, but I don't know if they can do that against Michigan. Too low. Almost intercepted. Calvin Hall is the man that he wanted. Woodrow Hankins was the man that it bounced up to.
Well, this is a classic defensive football game here early in the ball game, and coaches trying to find something to work and trying to get in this a position to win the field position war to make your offense only have to go 40 or 45 yards for a touchdown.
Good look at Woodson, who is back in single safety. Hayden Stockton, senior out of Oakman, Alabama, waits for the snap back at the 22. You just joined us, 3-0. Crimson Tide lead, second quarter. Great kick, good coverage kick. Woodson all the way back to the 13-yard line. Got a great block, tries to take it into the boundary, and he's down at the 30. That's a 52-yard kick, and he gets 17 on the return. We'll be right back. Now there's a look at him on the sideline, no worse for wear. But his teammates were gracious. They saw that he had lost his lid and didn't bang on him too high. Big John Causey sitting in the offensive line huddle right there. John, a senior out of Haneyville, Alabama, one of the co-captains and certainly one of the best at Mario, the right tackle that you're looking over his shoulder as they visit with scheme and what they can change to be more effective against this Michigan defense. Straight ahead, nice run. Floyd puts a head down, going to wind up with 11 yards in the play. Myers makes the tackle.
Well, Chris Floyd was injured most of the year. They're happy to have him back at Michigan. Brought Charles Woodson into the ball game, shifted him outside, and then ran the fullback up inside on a trap.
It's Andre Short. Watch, here comes Andre.
Just ran right over him.
Watch his headgear go the other direction. Whoa.
Not so concerned about that headgear as he was. His body was going back, too.
Now the training staff came out, and you can see him shaking his head. He said, I'm fine. I'm enjoying it here in Michigan. They do have palm trees in Michigan, don't they? Flags are down, and this is going to be procedure. And that play was doomed from the get-go as Floyd was tackled in the backfield.
Offside, defense into the zone, 5-yard penalty, first down.
So, Alabama turned what would have been a loss on the play, and they have just stepped off 5 yards against Michigan. They're going to have to go the other direction because it'll be a first down and 5 rather than first and 15. And the Michigan fans are now beginning to give the officials a little bit of a problem. Now Gene is on the side judge.
Well, a little confusion out there right now. Brian Greasy is off to a big start here, Ron. In control of this ball game, throwing a little short passes.
83 yards. 6 of 8 so far. 3-0, Alabama leads. With the left guard moved, you could see him come out of his stance. That's Damon Denson, and they're going to give the 5 yards back. And this one should not take a committee meeting to step it off. Well, ESPN2 has a New Year's coming to you. Wishing you a very happy new year, 1997, from Tampa, Florida. The Outback Bowl, Michigan and Alabama. 12:05 to play until halftime. 3-0 Crimson Tide. Creasy under heavy pressure throws the pass complete. He's got Tumanis tied in, and Creasy really took a shot from Ralph Staten. Mike, he went down hard.
Well, what you try to do when you play against a team that runs a lot of man coverage and a lot of blitz is try to bunch up your receivers a little bit. See, here's a tight end coming across in motion, but this is the tight end, Tumen, that's going to go right in the flat area. So you try to get a rub off on different players, and Jeremy Tumen out of Liberal, Kansas, makes that catch. Trying to take advantage of trying to get people to bump into each other.
Shotgun is Williams. Great second effort across the 50. He's going to have the first down. They had him at the 50-yard line short of the first down, and the second effort took him away from Rudd.
Good job again by the Michigan offensive line, led by Rod Payne, the great center of Michigan.
Jeremy Tumen, sophomore out of Liberal, Kansas.
Here's the blocking by the offensive line. Damon Denson pulling around, number 51.
Big John Jensen, also number 77.
Good
Enjoyed
job.
Visiting with him yesterday.
Yeah, an outstanding young man.
Yeah. So the Alabama reminds him of Ohio State and the discipline of Penn State. That play goes for one as Paul Pickett from his middle linebacking spot comes over to stop it short.
Well, it's interesting in talking to the Michigan players yesterday because they said, you know, our first bowl game on January 1st for a long time, and you think of Michigan, you think of them always playing on January 1st. But I think the reason they were so fired up for this football game was Alabama. They were playing Alabama,
yeah.
the ghost of Bear Bryant, the tradition, and they all said it. It's great to be here to play Alabama.
And you know, Mike, truthfully, the respect is mutual on both sides. Alabama feels the same way. Heck, they're playing Michigan. Blitz is on, and he's hit by Andre Short. And boy, Alabama likes to bring that safety up close to the line of scrimmage and bring him. And he hit Greasy just as he was delivering the football.
Yeah, that's what Brian Greasy has to see, that butt. That's difficult to see because Alabama moved to it very late. Short, number 23, is going to move and on this blitz and hit Brian Greasy in the back. Again, Mike DuBose, who's going to be the new head coach at Alabama, the defensive coordinator, has kind of changed the defensive philosophy at Alabama a little bit. A lot more blitzing than they did under the previous defensive coaches.
Marcus Knight has checked into the lineup as you look at Mike DuBose. Marcus is a freshman. Greasy. Got a man open, delivers it, and has the strike at the 32-yard line as Sigler comes over to make the tackle. And it's the young man we were just talking about, Marcus Knight, a freshman out of Sylacauga, Alabama. So that's got to be special for him.
Well, it is special. And, again, a nice play call by Fred Jackson. Again, he goes to two tight ends, two tight end look. He gets heavy protection for Brian Greasy. They blitz him out. You get all of a sudden, you get good blocking. He's able to sit in there, find Marcus Knight for the reception.
Good for 13 yards and a Michigan first down. Under 10 minutes until halftime. And again, you see Michigan moving people around. Shaw to the top of your screen. Goes straight ahead with the handoff to Floyd, and he's loose. Down to the 20-yard line, and they're going to spot him down at the 19. Cedric Samuel took his feet out from under it.
Ron, when you do this, when you ship someone out of the backfield, then all of a sudden you get the safeties moving and there's nobody in center field. All of a sudden now you shift number 4, Russell Shaw, out there. There's nobody in center field. So if you can bust through the defensive line, now a secondary hit player has to come over and make the tackle on Chris Floyd.
So Michigan with their best-looking drive of the afternoon, or the morning, I should say. That run good for 14. Straight ahead. Whoa, there's nothing there. Center field was filled that time by Dwayne Rudd. Center field, second base, and shortstop. Let's go down and check in with Kellen Winslow. Kellen.
Well, Ron and Mike, we talked about the weather at the beginning of the broadcast. I mean, for the most part of the second quarter that we've had so far, big cloud cover came over and really cooled the field off. Now, cloud cover's moving off, the sun's back. But I can tell by the sideline action on both sides, Alabama and Michigan, that this weather is starting to take a toll on some of the players, especially in these long drives.
Yeah, those big offensive line, but every time we get a shot, they are taking advantage of the break time. And as I mentioned, both teams very free with their substitutions of both wide receivers and running backs. Second down, Creasy. Short drop pass, incomplete. Cedric Samuel was just standing right there waiting for Ty Streets.
Well, a two-man route. They kept everybody else in the block. They're so conscious of the blitz by Alabama. They do not want their defense to feed off a big play. A turnover, hit Brian Greasy in the back. They do not want to allow him to do that. And they had that play open. Ty Streets just didn't make the pick, didn't make the catch.
One of the things that Lloyd said yesterday is he said, if you want to be hard-headed and have people spread out all over the place and try to throw against this team, he said, you'll run out of quarterbacks because with their safeties and linebackers, they will hit you many times.
Yeah, you'll need a relief pitcher.
Third down. Line to make is the 10, and Greasy wants a timeout. So let's take it with him. 8:46 remaining until halftime. Alabama by 3. To the area hospitals and visit, and some shots there of the players, and that's exactly what they did this past week. Ron Franklin, Mike Gottfried, and Kellen Winslow, and a happy new year to you. We come to you live from Tampa, Florida. 8:46 left in this opening half for the Wolverines. It's a third down, Mike, and maybe just over 10 for the first down.
And this is a tough defense to get 10 yards on, but what you want to do is try to get some kind of pick play with one of your receivers. Don't make a mistake, or you still want a chance to kick the field goal if you don't make the first down.
Shea is in the tight end. Here comes the blitz. He's hit from behind by Ralph Staten. He never had an opportunity because he never saw him.
Well, and as I said, it's a difficult defense to get in third and 10 with, but you want to save the field goal opportunity. Brian Greasy did that. Didn't have a chance. Ralph Staten with the hit in the back.
So Hamilton will come on to attempt a field goal. As you can see, Staten, who is just lightning quick, and Rudd was on the other side, and they just made a sandwich. This is going to be a 44-yard attempt. Almost the identical spot where Brock kicked his for Alabama. Plenty of distance, and he is good. We're tied. 8:03 until halftime. It is Alabama 3 and now Michigan 3. Let's see if it bothers him. And it's going to be about 3 yards deep in the end zone and not going to matter.
Alexander down to the end zone.
Well, when you look at the resume, an assistant coach, 58 through 64. Head coach at Texas A&M was with the Cowboys and Tom Landry. The Cardinals, and of course, 7 years here with the Alabama Crimson Tide.
And when you look at Gene Stallings, you're talking about one man, but I think it's been a tough period of time for the assistants because it's been unsettling. Woody McCorvey may lose his position as offensive coordinator. Jim Fuller's retired, so it's been a tough time for the assistants.
Kitchens, draw play. Sean Alexander, and he will take it for short yardage because Marcus Ray stepped up into the hole to make the hit on him. And, of course, off the staff, as you look at Woody McCorvey, DeBose will become the new head coach after this game today.
A very popular choice in the state of Alabama, former Alabama player, and I think everybody is that's associated with the university is very pleased that he will be the new head coach.
Second down at about 9. That's Vaughn in motion. Play action. Kitchen zings it over the middle. Has Vaughn. That's good for the first down out at the 35-yard line.
Good crossing route. Freddie Kitchens again showing that he's impressing the defense of Michigan on the other side because he's not making bad decisions in this ball game either. Good play action fake. You see the crossing route. Tight end cleared it out, and here comes Michael Vaughn across. Linebackers vacated the area, and Michael Vaughn wide open.
Mike, he grabbed his right hamstring. Kitchens did after he threw the ball all the way back to the huddle. We'll keep an eye on it. Reverse it. Got a man wide open. That's his tight end, Rutledge. And he'll be knocked out of bounds by Taylor. And following a 13, maybe a 14-yard gain.
I think another thing interesting is when you look at both these teams, they're saying that it's going to be difficult to run. Now, if you've watched Alabama all year, they are not a prolific passing team. But all of a sudden, they're coming out saying, hey, I think the only way we're going to move this football is throw the ball and maybe open up the run a little later.
Well, you see the numbers on Kitchens. Not great yardage, but great percentage.
Yeah, but that's what you want. You don't want to put him in bad situations where he may have to throw an interception against heavy coverage.
So it's first down almost at midfield as the Michigan corners creep up tight. And here they come with the blitz. And Kitchens, a little stop and go route. And he just overthrows it. Probably the smart thing to do there. As Woodrow Hankins was out there on Buchanan.
Yeah, that was covered right from the start. And then on the other side, you had Michael Vaughn. He was working against Charles Woodson. See the matchup right here. Charles Woodson just so fluid in that back pedal against a very good receiver.
Yeah, that's two really good athletes going head-to-head right there.
But Freddie Kitchens was looking to the other side. Couldn't come back because of the blitz to that side.
You see big Pete DeMario along with LaRon White, the offensive lineman, going up against a tough cookie right here in William Carr, senior out of Dallas. He dominates a lot of people, and he told us yesterday, I want to prove my point. I want to earn my respect on that field on Wednesday. Kitchens is sacked, and it's Glenn Steele. And on the other side, Carr, he couldn't run there because that's where William was.
Well, it's interesting when you look at Glenn Steele, because when Michigan played Ohio State, Lloyd Carr and the coaches said, you know, we match up real well against Ohio State's offensive line, but there's one area where they have an advantage. It's Orlando Pace. And if Glenn Steele can just get a draw for us in that ball game, we can win that football game. And he played very well, Glenn Steele, in that football game against Orlando Pace, and they won the ball game.
That's a loss of seven, so it's third down. Line to make is the Michigan 43. They creep up on the corners, and here they come. Kitchens, nobody open. Now he finds somebody and just throws it away.
Michigan's not going to allow Freddie Kitchens just sit back there and throw the football. They're going to heat him up and try to make him move around a little bit. They want to see if he can throw on the run.
More blitzes that time by Michigan, and Alabama seemed more confused on that series than any yet.
Well, the reason is when you sit back as defensive coordinator and see him, and they see the same statistics that you see, all of a sudden he's 8 out of 9. You've got to make him move around a little bit. You've got to put a little heat on him, and they did that the last series.
Speaking of heat, this guy here can do it to you. It is incumbent upon Hayden Stockton to get a good one away. Not particularly high. It's returnable. And Woodson breaks it open. He's got one man to beat. And Stockton will push him out of bounds just across midfield. So let's take a timeout. Will that be the break that... Great look at the sunbathed stadium in Tampa, Florida, the Outback Bowl. And this man right here has just put the Michigan Wolverines in a great situation. Two returns. That one was 31, and he's averaging 24 per try. Mike, you have to wonder if Alabama will continue to kick to it. Hayden Stockton saved it.
Yeah, he's exciting.
Stockton knocked him out of bounds. So next time out, we'll see if the Tide does kick to it. Ball is loose, recovered by Michigan, and Mark Campbell was right there. The ball fell right in front of him, and he was able to save it. Now, when Michigan doesn't turn the football over, they're a very good football team.
Yeah, they had 13 turnovers in their three losses, so they gave the games away, really. I mean, you're right. When they play within themselves, don't make a lot of mistakes, they're very difficult to beat.
Right now, we're tied at 3 apiece. And look at this right here in the turnover margin. Just what Mike was talking about in the three losses, minus 10 in the turnover margin, plus 11 in those 8 victories. Michigan's got great field position and plenty of time as we hit the 5-minute mark until halftime. Flag comes down and Howard tries to get it outside. He'll pick up a couple. Hernando Bryant from that cornerback spot.
I think the receiver from Michigan turned up too quickly. No, they're going to get Alabama. Ron, when you find a team that blitzes as much as Michigan or as Alabama does, what they'll do is they'll listen to the quarterback's cadence. And when they get bearing in on the cadence, then they can blitz you and time it up with the quarterback. And what Brian Griese has to do here from here on in is adjust his cadence. Now, maybe he caught him there offsides on that play, but he has to adjust that thing so that the defense doesn't get used to his cadence and can time those blitzes up, because they've hurt him in the third down situations.
It's a really big play right there, because Michigan scrimmages with a second at about 7. They would have had a third down at about 9. Straight ahead, not much on the running play.
They're trying that trap again. Up inside with Chris Floyd. They bring you Charles Woodson in, so everybody in the stadium figures that Charles Woodson's going to get the football, and then they try to sneak Chris Floyd up there in the trap.
So it is third down, and for Michigan to keep this thing going, they got to take it to the Alabama 37-yard line.
Now let's see if Alabama blitzes him. They've had success on third down going after Brian Griese.
And Woodson back off the bench and on the field. And it looks as though, yeah, he's going to line up at tailback.
Well, they may shift him out.
Yep, they do. Here comes the blitz. Griese gets it away. They just had to throw it too soon. They were all over him, and now here's a late flag that has come in. Alabama, you can see the cheer by Michael Myers. And that is a holding call against the Wolverines.
Lloyd Carr and his staff have to figure a way to slow this blitz down on third down, because every third down they're coming after Brian Griese and getting to him. You see the pressure in the back. Right through the hands of Charles Woodson.
Well, they're going to decline it. Peristaris will come on to kick it away. And Goss now is going to be looking into that very high sky as you look at Peristaris. Runs away from it. Now this takes a Michigan bounce and is going to go dead around the 10-yard line. Well, there's more college football today.
Michigan has to hold Alabama down here. Expect to get a field goal to take the lead here before the half. Alabama on the other side has to get out of this area right here, the 10-yard line.
Pitching spins and hands the ball off, and there's not much there. You can see Ben Huff, number 53, along with Marcus Ray filling the hole.
Marcus Ray's an interesting story. He's from Columbus Eastmore High School, which is 10 minutes from Ohio State Stadium. And an Eastmore graduate was Archie Griffin, who's an athletic director. Of course, a great player at Ohio State, and tried to talk Marcus Ray into attending Ohio State. But Marcus said when he visited there, he said they had two goals on the board: win the Big Ten and beat Michigan. He said there must be something special about Michigan, so I'm going there.
Second down and long. As Kitchens play action, gets his pass away, and this one is intercepted. That's Charles Woodson as he just threw it up for grabs. And Woodson is in danger getting a penalty here with the headgear off.
You wait for a chance for a turnover, and the Michigan defense gets the first one. And Charles Woodson, number 2, was sitting back in good coverage, but this ball is thrown very poorly by Freddie Kitchens. He just put this one up for grabs, trying to get the ball to Michael Vaughn, and Michigan now in business with 2:54 to go in the half.
Let's check in with Kellen Winslow. Kellen?
Well, Ron and Mike, speaking of Woodson, we were watching him early on the punt return, and he came in as a wide receiver, first splitting up in the backfield. He looked to be a very tired young man. Then he came out to have to cover as a defensive back on a wide receiver. I thought Alabama was going to take a shot at him, but instead Kitchen decided to throw to the back, but Woodson was Johnny on the spot to make the interception.
Yeah, and that pass was wounded. Griese sets in the pocket on first down, swings it out of the backfield, and Clarence Williams can't get over to that one. Rudd was coming out to make the cover on him.
The way this game's going, you look for ways to get 3 points, not 7, because you try to figure out how you can inch it close enough to get your kicker in a position. And when you're calling plays, Fred Jackson, the offensive coordinator, Stan Parrish, the quarterback coach, Lloyd Carr, trying to find a way against this great Alabama defense. And Mike DeBose now is trying to look for that stop. He wants the turnover to get the ball back for his offense.
Well, Kitchens knows by now, just as Griese knows, that these defensive backs are too talented just to throw it up for grabs out there. You're going to get it picked up. Counter play. Williams going to be knocked down for a loss, and it's Michael Myers.
Michael Myers is an outstanding defensive lineman. Came out of Hines Junior College. Fred Jackson, the offensive coordinator of Michigan, said he's the best defensive lineman we've played against all year. And he shows you right here as he gets into the backfield and makes the tackle on Clarence Williams.
And your friend up at Ole Miss cries every time he sees him because he had committed to go to Ole Miss, didn't make his score, then went to Hines, and then wound up at Alabama.
Well, what happened?
So Tommy Kirby.
Yeah, John Copeland, the lineman, had left Hines and gone on to Alabama and had success, so he wanted to do the same thing.
Gracie set to throw. Middle screen is there. Clarence Williams gets a block, and he's going to be tackled short of the first down by about a yard. It's Sigler who's holding on for dear life. Alabama read it, but they couldn't get back in.
Yeah, they couldn't get off the blocks, Ron. That's a good call and a good throw by Brian Greasy because it sets the field. There's no choice here. I mean, you kick the field goal. This is a game that's going to be won by your defense and won by your special team. So Michigan fans are saying go for it, but you go for the 3 points right here.
Yeah, they're both sides have stopped running plays for loss of yardage. It's going to be a 44-yard attempt. Everything has been right in this spot of the field. Just put a circle there. And it's a fake right up into the middle, and they break it. That's Greasy. At the 10, first and goal, Michigan.
The benefit of playing in a bowl game, and you watch every tape and film of the other team, and you look for a chance to spring a special teams play, and your quarterback is your holder, Brian Greasy. A pre-played call all the way. They saw something in the tapes of Alabama that allowed them to make that call and get that big first down.
It's good for 18 yards. So now the clock becomes very big. 109, now 108. It is a first and goal, the ball at the 8-yard line. Gozell Powell. Time to step up big if you're Alabama. There's the counterplay almost into the end zone. Chris Howard will take it to the 2 and credit Rod Payne, 52, with an outstanding paving block.
Yeah, Ron, you're right. Rod Payne had a great block. He was voted by the players as the most valuable player on the football team. Number 52 in the middle. Turns back. Good block.
Greasy puts the ball into the turf to stop the clock. Only 30 seconds left until the halftime. We're tied at 3. And you're right, Mike. Touchdowns are like Grand Slam home runs in this one.
Oh, they are. They're big because then you get the other team to play out of character a little bit if you can get that touchdown lead.
This is one of those things where touchdowns in this game are as rare as Christmas bonuses. Let's check in with Kellen Winslow. Kellen?
Well, Ron and Mike, maybe Mike can comment on this, but why would you down the ball like that when you got 3 timeouts on the clock?
Well, I'm not sure of that.
You end up wasting it down.
Yeah, you're right.
Now you call a timeout, nothing's lost.
And now you call a timeout. They just called a timeout.
I think, Kellen, the reason is I only think they have 1 timeout left, and they were trying to save that timeout to set up the field goal.
So we'll be right back, tied at 3, 30 seconds left until halftime.
A tough decision right here because with no timeouts left on, they were trying to save a timeout for their field goal team, but now they're in a tough situation here.
Now they got 9. Greasy looks for the end zone. Nothing there, and he was knocked out of bounds, and the ball goes out at the 5-yard line.
That's a break
for Michigan.
You're right. Because if they make that tackle and then you tell your defensive players, lay on them as much as you can so that they can't get up to kick this field goal. But we're still, you talked about touchdowns rare. We're still back to a field goal attempt. Brian Greasy, I like the call by Lloyd Carr because it gives you the option of the pass and the run. If it's not there, throw the ball away and stop the clock.
So this attempt right here is going to be 22 yards to try to put Michigan on top by a field goal. Seconds left until the halftime and our new score, the Wolverines 6-3.
Ron, I want to go back again because there was some really controversial decisions made on that play. But if you're on the sideline and you've got 25 seconds to make a call, it's not like up here. I mean, we can stand up here all day and got a tie on here and it's cool up here and the fans are sitting in the stands and But down there, I mean, it's hot and heavy, and there's a lot of things going on, and all of a sudden somebody's saying, let's run the ball. Or somebody said, let's take the timeout. And sometimes, some things happen that are out of the ordinary. Now, they'd like to have that timeout left, but they were saving that one timeout to set their field goal up if they needed it, and then, of course, they spent it.
With his team on top in this ballgame, 6-3. And he just pooches it. It's going to come to the 15-yard line. That's gone. And he'll be tackled at the 26. Chris Fowler, let's check with you.
Well, Ron, coming up in just a few seconds on our new Dodge halftime report, the final points from Pasadena. Mike Tirico, Mike Adamley will check in on the Rose Bowl. Well,
Ron, who do you think wins the Rose Bowl?
I think if it's dry, Arizona State. I think just like the weather, you talked about taking Auburn out of this game last year. I think if it rained, Arizona State hadn't played a game in the rain in 27 games. You know?
I think Ohio State's going to smash them.
Do you?
Yeah, I really do.
Well, there's another dollar you lose. Wings it out of the backfield, incomplete. 9 seconds left.
Well, you figure this one's going to be just down it right here, Freddie Kitchens. 9 seconds to go. Don't make a mistake here and go to the locker room like you talked about earlier, 6-3. That was a safe call. You're just trying to throw the ball out, see if your running back can make something happen.
William Carr looking on intently. Causey comes out over the football. They don't look like they're going to go down on a knee. Looks like they may go for one more. Right? Yes, they are. Kitchens goes down, and it's Bowens who gets him, and that is the first half. Our score, Michigan 6, Alabama 3. Now let's join. There's Vaughn to the near side, 37, Sean Alexander. The sun, not quite as tough as it was. It's not as glaring as it was early this morning. Kind of hazy. Here comes the kick by Felix. No return on this one as Sean Alexander makes the catch 8 yards deep in the end zone.
Freddie Kitchens had a good first half, except for the one turnover where he put the ball up for grabs. 8, 13, 53 yards. Not a lot of yards. What Alabama's trying to do in the passing game is work against the linebackers of Michigan, so a lot of short passes.
So let's see. We'll find out quickly what the discussions were at halftime, but I don't think we're going to see a great change as far as game plan by either team.
No, I don't think so. They probably picked up some things they'd like to try to do a little bit better here in the second half.
This is Dennis Ritter. Tries to turn the corner and finally turns it up. He is in the vicinity of the 25. Sam Sward makes the stop on him.
Freddie Kitchens, you see now, past 15 yards, nothing. A 0-for-3 on the left side. But everything, the most completions right here, the highest percentage, a little flare for the back out of the backfield. But trying again to work on linebackers underneath coverage.
Gene Stallings paces the sideline. His final half as the head coach at the University of Alabama. Kitchens dumps it out, has it completed, is tied in, and Haight will take it out to the 35, and it's good for the Crimson Tide first down.
Patrick Haight had 12 catches coming into this ball game, and I think for Alabama to take the ball the length of the field against this Michigan defense, Patrick Haight has to be a big part of the offense because misdirection play, you're working against the linebackers again. Patrick Haight has great ability to catch the football, concentration. Jared Irons with that tackle.
Now, speaking of good football players, Jared Irons, he's a senior out of Houston, the Woodlands, just north of Houston, Texas. And, of course, his daddy was an outstanding professional player. Ritter, a lot of running room. And then all of a sudden it closes up. Nice job by Hankins and Marcus Ray. It looked as though Ritter was going to break that thing for huge yardage.
Good, again, secondary play by Marcus Ray. Come up and make that tackle. Dennis Riddle did look like it was going to break for a little bit more. Still 4 yards. Good carry.
One of the things that Michigan did in the first half, Mike, many times they made the Crimson Tide play with a second and long. This is the kind of offense you don't want to do that in.
No, it's key for Michigan on first down to hold Alabama and Alabama and vice versa to get 4 yards, because you want the mix of run and pass on second and third down. You don't want to always be in long yardage situations where you have to throw the ball. Alabama is not a passing team.
Dadrian Taylor is being helped off the field, and he is favoring either his left arm or shoulder. And Tommy Hendricks has come in replacing him, so we'll get a report. Second down, not much there. They try to stretch it out, and Riddle goes down, and Irons is there with Sword to make the tackle. Let's go down to check with Kellen Winslow. Very timely.
All right, Ron and Mike, an honor here to have Gerald Irons, NFL great, who used to hold a lot when we played against each other. Of course, he is the father of Mr. Irons for Michigan. Tell me about his being back for the fifth year.
Well, we're real happy for Jared to decide to come back, because he, of course, graduated last May and got his degree. But he wanted to always come back for a fifth year because he's had a great career here at Michigan. He wanted to come back and finish up strong. And today he will.
How tough was it for him growing up in your shadow?
Well, it wasn't tough for him because we never put any pressure on him to do what I did. I told him simply to find something that he enjoyed doing, and I would help him whatever it was, and it just happened to be football. So we work out. I have the unique pleasure of playing and training with all of my kids. I work out with Grant, Jared, and my oldest son, Jerry. I work out with all of them. So I'm in a unique situation that I'm a father, that I am literally living my dream. When you and I were playing, they were little kids. They used to come and watch us play. And someday I knew that they would also play in college, and also they'll ultimately play pro.
Okay, thank you. Ron and Mike, a very proud father with every reason to be.
Understandably so. And I'll tell you, there's a younger brother who's a senior who is 6'5", taller than Jarrett, but built the same way. So wonder if he'll wind up at Ann Arbor. Holding against Alabama was turned down, and they will kick it away. So Hayden Stockton standing back. And, of course, Woodson is a guy who's kicking it, and he just rides this one out of the park. Woodson all the way back to the one-yard line, looking for a spot to run, and he'll be stopped at the 16. 60 yards on the kick, and it's going to be 15 on the return. So let's take a break. 6-3, our score. Do that than what it looks like. Another one of the fun events that they have during bowl week here in Tampa for the Outback. Greasy counterplay, got an opening. Almost breaking it free is Chris Howard, all the way out to the 35-yard line. Andre Short tripped him up.
Ron, just before halftime, Michigan had the ball on the 2-yard line. Let's go back and look at what happened on that series, because they burned a timeout. They had one timeout left. They had second and goal on the 2-yard line. I don't think this is such a bad move. Brian Greasy stops the clock. Now you have third down, but he makes the timeout call there, which I think is a waste right there. But I think what happened was
wrong
Michigan.
Personnel.
No, I don't think so much wrong personnel. I think that they were trying to decide run or pass, and they couldn't make up their mind, so they took a timeout, settled for the play where they tried to throw it in the end zone and then kick the field goal. So I think what they did is, Ron, that rather than be safe than sorry, they took the timeout. So, you know, they wasted their timeout down there, but wanted to get the field goal.
Chris Howard hit behind the line of scrimmage by Ralph Staten. We'll check and see how many individual tackles that Staten has. He has had a truly magnificent ball game. Just has been all over the place. A former free safety in high school, possesses some really good speed. Here they come with that safety blitz. Put up the fade route and incomplete. Collision, as you can see, Fernando Bryant colliding with Shaw, and he just cut off the lane and took it away from him.
Yeah, that's what you want a defensive back to do. Fernando Bryant just did exactly what he needed to do on that play. But now here, Ron, is where Michigan has had loads of problems in this football game. Third down has been a big blitz down for Alabama. Now Alabama's looking for this turnover.
Chris Floyd checks into the lineup, number 7.
2-for-8 today on third down. Michigan has not been able to keep the chains moving. If they come after him again.
Greasy short drop. Getting pressured by Hood, gets it away, and it's caught. That's Knight. And Knight knocked out of bounds. What a grab. Cedric Samuel makes the tackle on him, but the freshman, what a huge one.
Yeah, Michael Myers explodes on the snap of the ball, and he gets right in the face of Brian Greasy. 96, Michael Myers explodes in the football, and he forces Brian Greasy now to move. And Brian Greasy is a pretty good athlete, looks for Marcus Knight, finds him. Another good play by Brian Greasy.
Good for 24 yards, and it's first down, Michigan. Early going to the third quarter. If you've just joined us, 6-3. The Michigan Wolverines on top. But a battle of field goal kickers and defenses so far. And they go with the fullback, and this is Floyd. And he'll take it to the 41. Paul Pickett and Dwayne Rudd combining in the stop.
Rod Payne again, the center of that offensive line for Michigan. William Carr, the nose guard, who practices against him every day in practice, says he's the best I've faced. And Jared Irons said there isn't a game that he doesn't give his all. So Rod Payne's a big leader for this Michigan offense.
Charles Woodson checks into the lineup, number two. Howard in motion, empty backfield, pressure is on, and they throw the screen, and that's actually a lateral, and he throws back to Greasy, and he falls down. Good heavens, at the 37-yard line. And folks, there was a wall that you could have used in Berlin out there. I mean, he could have walked into the end zone.
There's only one player from Alabama could have stopped that play, and Kelvin Moore, and he'd have had to get through five Michigan blockers. This play was designed perfect. It's going to be a quick pass out here to Charles Woodson. Then Brian Greasy's going to come out to the right side. The offensive linemen are going to leave Alabama alone. Come in. Now look at this blocker. Stop it right here if we could. Look at here. One player from Alabama that can make that play.
So it's third down. Third down and about four. See Alabama tight at the line of scrimmage. Here they come with another blitz. Great protection, and now it breaks down, and it's Paul Pickett who will get him a second time officially that the Michigan quarterback has been sacked today.
Well, Chris Floyd, the fullback, is blocking on Paul Pickett. He just didn't stay with him long enough. They had that designed to block perfect, but Chris Floyd left go of the block too soon. Paul Pickett made the tackle.
Paul Peristeris will come on to punt it away. Again, Alabama comes up with a big defensive stop when they need it. Dawes circles for the fair catch at the 1 yard line. What in the world is he thinking? Never seen a fair catch that deep.
Well, you have a rule, a 10-yard rule. You put your foot at the 10-yard and you don't get away from it.
Got a big foot. 6-3, and the crowd's still buzzing about the fair catch.
Yeah, Ron, you always tell your punt receivers to line up on the 10-yard line, put your feet on the 10, and don't back up. Well, you see, Chad Goss is inside the 5-yard line. He lost track of where he was, and then Gene Stallings giving him a little bit of an earful.
The only thing that you can figure in the youngster's defense, we talked about what a bright sky it is. He was so concentrating on the sun and making the catch, he totally lost track of where he was.
But that's why you put your feet on those 10-yard line and you fair catch and get away from the ball. And if it's over your head, you figure it's going to go in the end zone. This is big now for Alabama. Michigan's defense is going to turn the heat up right here on Freddie Kitchens. Look for the turnover, trying to force the turnover. Alabama's got to get this ball out of here.
John Causey out of the football. It is a second down at about 8. Kitchens going to go long. Looking for Vaughn, and it's overthrown at the 45. Charles Woodson had him step for step.
Yeah, that's a good play call, because what you're trying to do is throw the ball down the field. If it is picked off, it's like a punt. But working Michael Vaughn against the best defensive back at Michigan, number two, Charles Woodson. Good protection, just couldn't get him the football.
Well, I think it's imperative right now that Alabama pick up some decent yardage, or they're not even going to have a full 15-yard drop on this punt.
Yeah, they've had problems on third down, Ron. They have them just like Michigan. The defenses have owned third down.
One of six today. Kitchens. heavens. That could have been a 98-yard touchdown.
Ball thrown well, but what happened to Marcel West is he got turned around. He lost track of the ball, lost track of where he was at on the field. Working against Charles Woodson, but watch him get turned around. Now, he runs a corner route, but he tried to stop there. Now, his head's on a swivel, and he just couldn't find the football when he looked back to the left side.
That would have been an interesting foot race. Now, let's concentrate on Hayden Stockton. He cannot take a step back. He's only got a 12-yard drop here. If he does, it's a safety.
Look for Michigan to return this football.
Is not going to turn over, but he kicks it away from Woodson, and that probably is as good as you could do. It goes out of bounds, and let's check in with Kellen Winslow. Kellen?
All right, Ron and Mike, we have the sponsors here of the Outback Bowl, the principals of Outback, the firm of Sullivan, Basham, and Cannon back there in the background. Our speaker, Chris Sullivan. Chris, tell us about Outback's involvement in this bowl game.
Well, we had the opportunity to take the title sponsorship 2 years ago, and the community has just done a great job of promoting this game. The Tampa Bay community is a great, great place for business, and we've just had tremendous success here. And we want to thank all our people at Outback. They've really made this possible around the country, and it's a terrific opportunity for our company to get exposure and talk to people about Outback everywhere, from California to Florida to New York. And we've been really, really impressed with this kind of a day, and the game's terrific. And we're just looking forward to more and more of this kind of success as years move forward with this bowl game.
All right, Chris, thanks a lot. Thank you, guys. We know we're having dinner tonight.
Well, I'll tell you what, Michigan slowly but surely is figuring out the blitz and finding plays that will work. That's Russell Shaw, good for 14 yards on that one there. And a nice job by Greasy to get out of harm's way.
Misdirection plays again. Brian Greasy's good on his feet. He's able to roll away from the pressure and find Shaw down the field. But now Mike DuBose needs his defense to step up here and shut the door on Michigan's offense.
6-3, Michigan lead. Williams, and Clarence is going to have three on the play. Steve Harris, a sophomore out of Town Creek, and Kevin Jackson combining on the stop. Kevin, seven interceptions, leading the SEC this year, and first team All-American on many teams.
And here's Ron, when you talk about seven interceptions, he's also one of the top four tacklers out of that safety position. Alabama uses a scheme where they're going to get the safeties up involved in the run.
Field, and there's not much there. Ralph Staten again, and how many times have we called his name today?
It's going to come down to this now, Ron, a third down. Blitz by Alabama. You can guarantee there's going to be a blitz here, and how Michigan handles it to put themselves in another field goal situation or whether they can get this first down. But they're going to face the speed and quickness of a blitz here.
See, you know, Ty Streets has only caught one ball today. And they try to find him. There's the pressure, and he knocks the ball loose, and Greasy does the only thing he can do, and that is fall on it to keep Alabama from capturing it. And it's Michael Myers who just messed up everything.
Well, the Michigan coaches talked about Michael Myers, the respect they had for him. He explodes again, 96 off the speed of the rush, and then also Ralph Staten's coming from the outside. They're very fortunate, Michigan, to get that ball back, but knocked out of field goal range again. Defense for Alabama stepped up big.
Mike, are you surprised there's a new return guy in for Alabama?
No. No, but he's going to find a 10-yard line.
Sigler, and I'll tell you what, Mike is right. His feet are anchored at that 10. Signals for the fair catch and makes it at the 9. So let's take a timeout as you look at Michael Myers and the Alabama defense. They trail by 3. At future events here on ESPN, Captain Terry Dillard piloting that one today, and he's got some great looks. New quarterback in the ball game for the Alabama Crimson Tide as Riddle takes the ball and comes out close to a 10-yard gain.
And the new scheme bringing in Warren Faust into the ball game, a little bit more of a running quarterback, a little bit more of an option game, and that's the benefit of a long period of time preparing for a bowl. You can do a lot of things offensively you can't do during a week's time of preparation during the regular season. And the Michigan defense will say, welcome to the ball game. David Bowens, number six, with a good hit.
Mike, I'll tell you who's slow, and now he has come off the field. William Carr was shaken up on that play. He stayed on the ground for a bit, wanted to go back to the huddle, and they coaxed him from the sideline to come over and take a break for a minute. It's a little in motion, top of the screen, and it's quarterback draw. And boy, Mr. Godfrey, you are exactly right. They've had a quarterback who was doing the two-step, and now they got somebody who's doing the jitterbug, so they're going to have to change some things defensively.
Well, I think Gene was funny the other day when we talked to him about quarterbacks. He says, you know, I go to practice every day. I watch practice. He's fans all, you want the other quarterback in, but I watch practice every day, so I know who the best quarterback is. But there is a time in the ball game when you insert a relief pitcher, and hopefully they can ignite your offense. Now, they tried that against Mississippi State. Of course, Mississippi State held on and beat the Alabama team.
Warren Fowles, sophomore out of Midwest City, Oklahoma. And of course, that is a suburb of Oklahoma City. Keeps this one, and he'll pick up the first down. He lost the ball, made it exciting at the last minute, made his own recovery at the 34. Mention him, Gene, as you did. I think a funny, funny story about him as a young kicker that just kicked the fire out of the ball. And every time Gene came around, the kid would shank it and kick it the wrong direction. So he went over and asked him one day, said, son, you get nervous sometimes. He said, coach, I can't kick when you're around. You make me nervous. And Gene grabbed him to the jersey and said, you do know I'll be at every game on Saturday, don't you?
And on the sidelines, looking at you.
First down, Alabama. They trail it 6-3. Just under 4 minutes to play, third quarter. Fowles rolls the ball out, turns the corner, has five, has 10 yards, and who does he get belted out of bounds? Charles Woodson. Well, following this game, stay with ESPN for the championship game.
That's when the ball spotted right now on the 45-yard line. We'll move it 2 yards forward. And that's where Michigan took it over on the 47-yard line in Alabama territory and came away with no points. So that's the job of the great defense.
Michigan gathers up tight. They're looking for the run, and they got it. This is Riddle. Tries to bounce it outside, and a nice tackle by Woodson. If he doesn't get him, there's big yardage. And let's check in with Carl Ravitch for an The kid is so much fun to watch. He is just pure when he throws it, doesn't he, Mike?
Yeah, he'll be back. He'll be back in college football next year.
I hope you're right. I hope you're right. Second down and five. The ball just shy of midfield. Fowles looking, still looking. He's going to run it. And he'll pick up a couple. He was tempted. Calvin Hall was almost open, but the defensive back from Michigan was just playing off the ball, trying to debate him.
Yeah, and what's happened to Michigan now is they have to change their game plan on defense, because all of a sudden you have a quarterback like Freddie Kitchens, who's a passing quarterback in a running game that's not going to run a lot, and all of a sudden you got Warren Faust into the game. The offense has changed. Now Jim Herman, the defense coordinator, has to make his change.
See this right here, Mike? This, to me, all these people with their hands on their knees, I think this guy is the one that's taking body shots. I think he will take it out of the Michigan defense if they continue to have success doing what they're doing.
Well, that's not a good sign when your head's down.
Here's the option to pitch. Riddle has five, has 10. He's loose down to the 30-yard line. It is first and 10, Alabama. Marcel West, one of the wide receivers, and Michael Vaughn with really good blocks.
Yeah, it's a different style of game now for Michigan. 81, Glenn Steele's coming to the sidelines. You're right, he's tired. But it's a different style of game now. All of a sudden, you have to defend the quarterback on the option. Obviously, Alabama has practiced a lot on the option in the bowl week. Preparation and a good cut by Dennis Riddle. This has been their most impressive drive of this day.
Riddle, 61 yards now on 11 attempts. They go back to the open side. There's the pitch. Riddle, nice job defensively. That is David Bowens, who stayed home on the wide side of the field, and he'll tackle him for a 5-yard loss.
Well, Jim Herman, the defensive coordinator, knows David Bowens very well because he recruited him out of Orchard Lake St. Mary's High School. And the first day you can call a recruit, the night you can call it, once midnight, he made the call to David Bowens at 12:01. Ron, at 12:03, he called Charles Woodson. It's not too bad of phone calls. You got two pretty good players.
I started to say that five of the best minutes in Michigan football history.
I think I'd have used two phones and called them both at 12:01.
5-yard loss on the play. It is second down and 15. They need to take it to the 20. It's Vaughn in motion. They pitch it back to him. Now here comes the reverse. Marcel West. West back into the middle. Loses the football. And Michigan has recovered at the 30.
They talked about it. I want to gain some respect today. Marcel West, number one. Charles Woodson stayed home. Number 29, Marcus Ray stayed home also.
He caused the fumble. It was Marcus Ray with the solid hit that caused the football to come loose. And what had appeared to be the best Alabama drive since back in the first quarter goes awry.
And that's big, Ron, because now Michigan can get their defense over the sideline and make some adjustments right now. I'm talking to them.
Gracie gets to Clarence Williams, breaks out of the pile, and he's loose. 50, 45, at the 40, and going to be tackled from behind by Fagan. That is good for 29 yards.
A beautiful job in the secondary by Michael Fagan, because you tell a defensive back when you're strung out like that, I mean, he's up here in the corner now, he's going to be pushed down the field as a receiver. Now Clarence Williams is going to get that football. He's going to break through. Now you look for Michael Fagan just to buy time. Do not let him get outside of you, force him back to the inside, and he did that. Saved a touchdown.
This could be the last play of the third quarter. Counter play. And he can't get out of that one. It'll be good for one as Kelvin Moore is down at the bottom of the stack. And that will be the end of the third quarter. So as we head to the final 15, it'll be the final quarter for this gentleman right here. And his team is down by three. Well, you take a look over the back of the Michigan defense and towels over heads now as it is really getting warm. Mike Elston, number five, standing there, the junior out of St. Mary's, Ohio. And the fan going over on the Alabama side as well. But as we stated earlier, it is much better considering what we had last year.
We had Noah's Ark last year at this time. Get out of here.
So we start the fourth quarter. Michigan at the 39. Williams breaks off the tackle and is going to wind up picking up about 5 yards in the play. Staten pushed him out. Kelvin Moore ran into him but didn't lock him up.
Ron, this is great defense, though. You've got to give credit to Alabama's defense. They're continually being put on the wrong side of the 50-yard line by their offense and mistakes, and they continually come up with big plays. Mike DeBose, the new head coach, is just trying to make plays to keep his ball club in it. Third down, I'd expect the blitz again on Michigan. See how Michigan handles it.
Third down, and the line to make is the 29-and-a-half-yard line. Michigan leads it 6-3.
Here they come.
Shaw in motion. There's the pressure. Look in, and here's a flag. Ralph Staten was just all over Greasy.
Big mistake there, trying to time up the count of Brian Greasy, and this time offside. Look at all of them up at the line of scrimmage. Never a chance for Brian Greasy. Ralph Staten, number 41. But now they're in a situation where they got a chance for the run here on short yardage.
So the 5 yards stepped off, and it is about a half yard short of the first down. '88, Mark Campbell comes in from the bench, bringing the play, as well as '85, Marcus Knight.
And the way Michael Myers is roaring up the field, you figure they're going to probably run away from his side.
Straight ahead, quarterback sneak, and he has it. Kellen Winslow, let's check with you.
Well, Ron, I'm down on the sideline with a young man I used to watch play when I... No. He's a lot younger than I am. Eric Curry, All-American at Alabama, member of the national championship team. Eric, tell us about your memories of Coach Stallings.
Well, Coach Stallings was definitely a man of... you know, he was a person, a father image. Everybody seemed to love him, and everybody seemed to corral around him. And it was more or less like a big brother to everyone, and, you know, he's definitely been a great success and great asset to Alabama, and I have all congratulations to him and the career he's had here. And like I said, you know, you see most of the guys here, and everybody seemed to, you know, enjoy being around him and just love the type of atmosphere, so it's definitely a great thing for him.
Now, when you came to Alabama, he preached defense to defense. Was that one of the reasons why you came to play for a man like Gene Stallings?
Well, first, it was Curry. It was Curry who I first came to play with. But Stallings preached. You know, he was more or less like a hands-on coach.
Right.
He'd more or less come around. He would, you know, have a little say-so about the offense, say-so about defense. But his main priority was to make sure that everybody played defense, because defense wins. You know, that's it. Hey, if you can't get your offense on the field, you can't score no points. Right.
So thanks a lot, Eric. Appreciate it. Good luck to you in the NFL.
Tell everybody Happy New Year, too.
I sure will.
All right.
Michael Myers comes across and makes contact. Now let's see if a Michigan player moved first or if it is going to be another five-yard penalty against Alabama.
Prior to the snap, contact by the defense, offside, five-yard penalty, first down.
Well, that's two on this series. That is really big, Mike. Two first down. Well, the other one led to a first down because he only had a half a yard, and now they give him one. Straight ahead, they give it to Floyd. Breaks it out of the tackle. Down inside the 10, and he's to the 7-yard line. Ready. Well, Peyton Manning off and running, so to speak. Our situation here, 6-3, and they have a first down or a second down. They only need about two inside the 10. Running play, hit in the backfield. Chris Hood comes free, and he'll knock him down for about a 4, maybe a 5-yard loss.
Well, they needed that kind of play out of the Alabama defense because Michigan getting close in this situation. They want to hold him to a field goal attempt here. No one blocked Chris Hood on an inside move, made the tackle on Chris Howard. And Ron, Michigan's offense, they figure they can control the game here in the fourth quarter with their big offensive line. They ran the same play against Ohio State 11 times in the fourth quarter, so they depend on wearing down the defense.
Third down. They need to take it to the 5-yard line to pick up the first. That's Campbell in motion. Greasy. Hit, and the ball is intercepted by Rudd. And Rudd may score. There are no flags on the field. We'll count it off. 20, 15, 10, 5. Touchdown, Dwayne Rudd.
Curry say on the sidelines, defense wins. That's what they preach at Alabama. And they look for a mistake, and they got it. And again, the Alabama defense comes up big with the turnover that they get for 6 points.
And it's interesting that Coach Carr said yesterday, as we walked across the field toward his locker room, he said, I know Staten is fast. In fact, I think he's faster. But he said, Rudd, to me, is as good a linebacker as I've ever tried to coach against or prepare for. Brock with the extra point attempt, and he's good. 12-13 left in the ball game, and our new score is Alabama 10 and Michigan 6. Let's take a break. Another look at it. It is the longest interception return for a touchdown in Alabama's long storied bowl history. We'll look at it after the
and
kick.
And Ron, Michigan has not handled pressure very well again today, and that was the key difference.
Willie Watts with the kick. 5 yards deep, and not going to bring it out. Tyrone Butterfield.
Well, here's the pressure on the outside. Kelvin Ziegler, number 20, is going to come from the outside. There's no one to pick him up. Now, he makes the hit. Brian Greasy just shouldn't have thrown the football. Now tries to throw the football, puts it up for grabs. Wayne Rudd, who's blocking and entangled with his cohort on the other side, breaks through, and Gene Stallings very happy on the sideline. But still 12-13 on this clock.
Oh, yeah. We had lots and lots of football.
But it's been a defensive game.
It really has. And we were talking during the break. I'm not so sure that wasn't a 14-point swing. I felt as though Michigan had found enough little keys that they were going to push that in for a touch.
What could be a backbreaker, we're going to see how Michigan really reacts to it right here on this series.
Good point. Here comes the safety blitz this time. Pass in the flat. They got it complete to Shaw. And he will be pushed out of bounds just short of the 30-yard line. That's Deshae Thompson who pushed him out.
You know, it's a good sign for the quarterback. Come back. Let him throw right away. Brian Creasy's a veteran. He's been around for a while. May or may not take his fifth year. I think a lot depends probably how this ball game goes. But I think he's played very well. He made one mistake there. He played very well. Freddie Kitchens on the other side made one mistake and it resulted in 3 points for Alabama. But the switch to Warren Faust has really generated Alabama's offense.
Second and short, and Greasy will take it straight ahead. Now, when you look at Alabama's defense under Stallings in the 90s, not even anything as far down as third place as far as the SEC, the first or second every year. And I remember we laughed earlier this year about Gene finally got fed up with everybody Thomas telling him that his offense was so ugly. And he said, if you want me to be pretty and lose, then you got the wrong guy coaching at this school.
Yeah, I think defense wins and running the football. Those are the two categories that go side by side.
Gracie, gonna go long. Foot race down the sideline, and Shaw can't get there. That's Fernando Bryant who is covering him.
Ron, you look for seniors now to take over. There's 11:42 to go on the clock, and a lot of key seniors on both sides of the field, but the offensive line has three. Thomas Wangs, Damon Denson, and, of course, the great center, Rod Payne. So they were having some success running the ball the last series against Alabama. Let's see if they go back and try to get Chris Floyd back to football.
Alabama shifting back and forth with stems just before the ball is snapped. That on the flat complete. And again, it's the freshman Knight hit immediately by Michael Fagan. And it's going to be a third down Michigan at about six to get this first down.
And Fagan has really come up big. Now, he was the defensive back that was able to keep that long run of Clarence Williams from going for the touchdown. And then a good short tackle on this last play, just allowing a five-yard completion.
Lloyd Carr pacing, knowing that clock is going to really start getting quick now. They need this first down right here. Now, you can see the movement on both sides. I'm not so sure that Alabama may be fortunate that this play got stopped. Mike, they were confused on who was going to cover on the outside. There was almost nobody out on Clarence Williams because he had taken him out of the backfield and split him out left.
A lot of shifting going on by Michigan.
Prior to the snap, defense in the neutral zone, outside, offense moves. 5-yard penalty.
Gene figures he's going to have 11 minutes to go to yell at these guys in striped shirts. He's going to take every advantage. He's been yelling at him his whole career. He's got 11 minutes to go.
Third down and short, and again the quarterback sneak, and they will pick up the first down. Clock now about to go under 11 minutes left in this 1997 version of the Outback Bowl.
Think about Gene Stallings and Lloyd Carr, what's going through their mind. Of course, Gene Stallings won the most important game for him, his last game versus Auburn, and won in the same kind of fashion. Trailed and took a drive to the length of the field, and Freddie Kitchens came through for him. Today, defense.
Motion, the running play, Clarence Williams, and he's behind those big blocking backs there. He'll take it for a couple, but Pickett and Hood will make the tackle. Oh, what a... Greasy has it complete and is going to be pushed back. Mike, let me ask you something. Were they going to run a hook and ladder?
I don't think so. I think we're right through the hands of Aaron Shea, number 36. They're trying to go to him, and it just went right through his hands. Aaron Shea, and then Ty Streets with good concentration makes the catch, and you need a little luck every now and then.
So the ball is placed down at the 46-yard line. You were talking about how big that game was for Gene Stallings to win, though, but the same at Ann Arbor up in the Big Ten Conference for Michigan to have the Buckeyes number again. And they were down and had to come from behind in that game. Lawrence Williams bounces it outside. You can see the pursuit by Fagan, and he just stiff arms him down and has the first down. Kevin Jackson bumped him out of bounds, but it's a first down.
They've had more success in this quarter running the football than they have the entire ball game. And you got to figure that offensive line starting to weigh on this Alabama defense a little bit. But you still need good mix against this Alabama defense. You're not going to take the ball and run it right down the field, and you're not going to throw it. You need good mix in this case because this is a solid defensive unit.
This has been quite a 1-2 punch for Michigan this year. Chris Howard and then Clarence Williams. You can see the numbers on Williams. Pressure up the middle of the ball. Almost intercepted. Stepping in front was Bryant.
Everything short, Ron, because of they're afraid of the blitz, and they don't want to set Brian Greasy back there 5-7 yards deep. So everything's on three steps. Ty Streets, the intended receiver, Fernando Bryant breaking on the ball. He knows it's going to be a short passing game now. Gets a good break on the ball.
Actually, Streets played a little bit of defensive back there. That could have been a pickoff. Second down and 10. 10-3, Alabama leads, 9:27 left in our ballgame. Running play, 3 yards to the 30. And it's Michael Myers who's down at the bottom of that stack. And Clarence Williams getting up. Clarence only a sophomore. We'll see him for another couple of years up in Ann Arbor. 5'9", 195, sophomore out of Detroit. Had 779 yards, catches the ball well. And then Howard comes in. Howard had almost 700 yards himself.
Ron, it's interesting right here. You have to figure out whether you're in four down territory right here from Michigan, whether you're going to take the field goal if you don't get the first down. A lot of decisions for Lloyd Carr.
Gracie Setch looking long for the end zone and just beyond the hands of Marcus Knight. Deshae Townsend was trying to cover him. Greasy looks to the sideline, and we see movement by 19, Hamilton, and they will go for the field goal.
Just ran out of room right here. Brian Greasy may have left, may have waited just a little bit too long to leave this ball go. Marcus Knight, being shadowed by Deshae Townsend, number two, just ran out of room a little bit too far.
48-yard attempt, Mike. Greasy to holder. Now, they had a fake earlier, but I don't think the situation will avail itself here that they would call that. Down. Don't know if he's got the distance. Nope. Short and to the right. And again for Alabama, defense, defense, and more defense. Well, we're back in Tampa, 10-6, the Alabama Crimson Tide leading. And, of course, this man right here, after this afternoon, once about 8:41 ticks off the clock, officially will be the new head coach of the Alabama Crimson Tide. And you look at his pedigree, played for the Bears, 72 through 74, then defensive line coach, two different stints, defensive coordinator this season.
His goal always as a player was to play at Alabama, and his goal as a coach was to be the head coach, and he's made both his goals.
So here comes the Crimson Tide, and Freddie Kitchens is back in the ballgame. Warren Faust did his job. Dennis Riddle being corralled. He'll turn it upfield, and you can see on the outside, Marcus Ray not only made the hits, he's grabbing for the football as Michigan knows they got to take it away.
Freddie Kitchens back in the ballgame. I'm sure Gene Stallings wants the veteran back in. Now, Warren Faust came off the bench. He was the relief pitcher. He got the Michigan team out in the seventh, and this is Little League Baseball where you can bring the quarterback back in. Now, Warren Faust coming back in to try to put a little bit more pressure on this Michigan defense.
Tell you what, this if it were baseball, be hit on a scorekeeper, wouldn't it? There's Faust, option play, pitches back to Riddle, has 5, has 10, has 15, and it's an Alabama first down out across the 47, and again, an Alabama wide receiver, this time Vaughn with a great block. But let's check a marker back at the line of scrimmage.
Oh, Gene's going to get to yell some more here.
Look at it. Oh,
See, he doesn't have Saban's voice anymore. He needs to let it all go. And the poor guy on the sideline that you get on the side, he hears it all.
He hears it all, and the umpire, the guy who's in the middle of the field, the one who called it.
Now, he doesn't even look over there.
I found that goal, guys! I tell you, if Gene comes out any further, they're going to have to give him a helmet. He's on the field.
This guy's going to have an earache tonight, the official.
Will wrap him up from behind.
I'm fine.
This is a big sequence right here.
Well, it really is, because that Ben Huff made that play to start with, and then he forced it back into Glenn Steele. But you're right, still a lot of time, 7:34 on the clock, and Michigan now is looking for the turnover in third and long, but I'm not sure. Here comes Freddie Kitchens back in. Now the option's going now. You have the pass or the running play now, so Michigan has to adjust to Freddie Kitchens being back on the field.
Meanwhile, the clock runs. We're about to go under 7 minutes to play in this ballgame. Alabama up by four. Kitchens from the shotgun gets his pass away and almost intercepted as it was batted by Tommy Hendricks. Wow.
Well, they got away with one there. Tommy Hendricks, a safety, number 41. Ball was thrown into his hands, and now it's going to be back to the Alabama defense again, their kicking game. That's what's got him here.
Boy, this Michigan defense, they have played so well all year long, and he almost came up with their extra base hit right
there. And you talk about key performer Hayden Stockton. Now, you just what you talked about earlier, he did at LSU. He needs a big punt here to Woodson.
I'd kick it away from Woodson.
I would, too.
Averaging almost 25 yards of return. This is returnable. Woodson with the 27. Finally winds up at about 4 yards on the return. It is a 46-yard punt. Four on the return, and Steve Stanley got downfield to make the tackle.
Well, Michigan made a choice there to go after the punt, and when you rush the punt, you don't have a return on. Charles Woodson has to get everything he can get on his own.
Holding called against Michigan. So this will be stepped off back inside the 30. Well, according to his players, it wasn't on the field that Coach Stallings will be most remembered to them.
The impact he has on your life, not as just a player, but as a person as well. And it's just several things that he's instilled in us as far as a work ethic and just being a good person on and off the field.
He's a good example of the type of person you're supposed to be off the field. Does a lot of charity work for the people around town, and he's just a great influence on a lot of people's lives.
So, Coach Stallings got a penalty in his favor that time.
Well, that's why you yell at the official. You're hoping to pick one up.
Gracie sets in the pocket, great protection. Got a man open, juggles the ball, and it came down with it. Shaw had it, lost it, and had it again.
What a catch.
Fagan was just all over it. Close as you can cover without having interference. Nicely thrown.
One of the few junior college players at the University of Michigan, Russell Shaw. Coaches say he's always open. He's a great route runner. He made two catches on that play against Michael Deacon.
Yeah, he did. In fact, the official stats should give him two. 18 yards in the pass play. See the safety creeping up into your picture. They pick him up right over the middle. He's got Shaw. And if he breaks away, he's going to score. And it's Bryant holding on for dear life. So again, Michigan moving the football between the 20s. But then they get down there and start to bog down.
Well, here's why they're moving the football now. The two tight ends, there's two tight ends now. So now what you're going to have is two-man routes on the outside with a lot of protection in here. For Brian Greasy. They can't get to him, and they blitz. Fernando Bryant has to run with Russell Shaw. So now give that credit to Michigan because they had the right play on for the right defense.
24 yards on 26, rather. 18 on the one before. On first down, they from the counter, then the reverse to Shaw. gets a block to get to the outside, and Staten stays at home and makes the tackle. He has been the key guy so many times today.
It's tough to counter a team like Alabama that runs so well with the little reverse here. Ralph Staten stayed at home. He was blocked early, but then he got off.
Kellen, let's check with you quickly.
Round of the last change of possession, Coach DeBose pulled over his Alabama defense, and he talked about especially getting pressure up the middle on the pass rush, something they have not done on this last drive, giving Greasy time to find his receiver downfield.
Well, we've just gone under 5.5 minutes left in our ball game. Michigan, Clarence Williams hitting the backfield. Myers is there first, and then Rudd, who had the 88-yard interception return for the touchdown.
Now, there's no doubt Michael Myers has controlled the line of scrimmage today for Alabama. 96 just explodes again, comes up. He beats the block of Thomas Wines, number 75, just not able to reach into Michael Myers. And Ron, here's where Michigan doesn't want to make a mistake on third down. You're going to throw it down the field because you still have your three timeouts left and you can still punt Alabama in and play for this last drive.
The last play is the 11th time that Alabama's defense has thrown Michigan for a negative yardage play. And Greasy wants a timeout. So let's take it with him. 4:38 left in the ballgame. 10-6 Alabama. The situation. 4:38 left in the ballgame. Alabama in a defensive struggle. Neither offense has scored a touchdown. Rudd, 88 yards on an interception return, the linebacker for Alabama. And everything else has been field goals.
Ron, it comes down to right now whether your receivers are better than their defensive backs.
Third down, they need to take the ball to the 22 and a half. Alabama stays at home. They're going to try to get it done with the front four, and the ball is overthrown. Clarence is upset because he was open. The ball just eased over his head.
Still not a bad play. Now, fourth down, you're going to punt Alabama down. Hopefully, your punter will be able to get him inside the 10. Still have two timeouts left to go.
I was talking with the coaches yesterday, and they were saying that it is amazing how good Greasy is at pooch kicking, and he's standing back there right now.
He needs a big one here.
50% of the time, he's nailed it inside the 20 this year. Now, this is outside of the foot. Not going to be proud of this one. It does take a bit of a Michigan bounce and will go out of bounds at around the 24. 16 yards in the punt. In Manhattan, Saturday night, Michael, you ought to come along, put on your basketball hat.
Little Apple, right? Little Big Apple.
Manhattan, Kansas.
We got a big game today, Kansas State.
Alexander turns the corner, hang on, and he ran into his own man. Taylor makes the tackle, but his forward progress was actually stopped by his blocker, and that's the same kind of run that he had at, what, two over 70 yards for a touchdown against LSU.
Yeah, Ron, and you really have to look at, we talked about the unsettling effect of the coaching staff, and give credit to Woody McCorvey, the offensive coordinator, who doesn't know whether he's still going to be coaching at Alabama or not, or move to another position, and Jim Fuller, he's been an offensive line coach under three head coaches at Alabama, and his offensive line did a nice job there.
Down. Alexander going to be stopped for a yard loss. It's Glenn Steele, who has had a very good ball game today for the Michigan Wolverines as well. So it's going to be a second down and long. But the clock here, Michigan desperately needs to stop them on this series because a first down, Mike, would take it down between one and two or even inside of 1 minute before they might see the ball again unless they use one of their two timeouts left.
Yeah, and Alabama right now, Freddie Kitchens wants to use as much of the clock as he can before he runs this play.
I know this gentleman here says, I don't want to be the thing. It's the team and the program. But I know how badly he wants to win this final game today. Unbelievably large, that desire. Draw play, Sean Alexander. 5, 10, 15, he's off. A tackle just across midfield. And that was a huge nail in the coffin as far as Alabama is concerned.
Yeah, without a doubt, now you get past the 50-yard line. And you talked about it earlier, but when you have the depth of Alabama, Dennis fresh Riddle, you got Curtis Alexander, all of a sudden now you bring Sean Alexander in, and he's fresh. Everybody else is tired on the other side.
At 200,
and finally makes the tackle.
291 yards against LSU. That was a single game mark in the history of Alabama football. Scored four touchdowns, had runs of 73 and 72 yards in that game. This time he's going to be hit in the backfield, breaks off the tackle, though, and will wind up with maybe one as William Carr will stop him.
And he spoke at a coach's clinic last year in Alabama at the university, and he said, my two goals, Sean Alexander, is to be an All-American and the Heisman Trophy winner at Alabama. So he was recruited by Michigan, but chose to go to Alabama instead.
Michigan has just taken a timeout. We'll take it with him. 2:25 left in our game. 10-6, Alabama leads it. This man has 2 minutes and 25 seconds left in his coaching career at Tuscaloosa. Yesterday, a special time for him because he's going to be able to spend more time with his son, John Mark. And John Mark loves his football program, is constantly around when he can. And in fact, Gene buttoned up his collar and had him sit with the team for the team photo that was taken yesterday. And I asked him after that, where John Mark had gone, and he said he's down in the training room. He likes to put ice packs on people after they've worked out. That's a special relationship between those two, which Gene will be, as I said, able to spend a lot more time with John Mark now that that he's retiring. Moving off to Paris, Texas. Vaughn in motion, top of your screen. Got a draw play, Sean Alexander. Got more speed than you think, and Michigan just found out he will score. Yards. And there finally is the smile. The Gene is going to win his 70th. There's John Mark and the family upstairs. Mike, this young fellow right here, you watch him running, you think, like I said, you think he's not moving that quickly, and all of a sudden, whoosh, he's by you.
I think, again, credit Woody McCorvey, the offensive coordinator, Gene Stallings. They have been able to substitute perfectly in their running back situations to have a fresh running back here in the second half.
Sean Alexander has come in 8 carries, and now with a total of 99 yards and a touchdown. One more look at the touchdown. You see him cut to the outside. Irons did not guess his speed properly, and there he goes, 46 yards, and he'll score the touchdown.
And a good block by Shamari Buchanan, number 84. It really springs him on Charles Woodson.
Mike, when you look around in the Southeastern Conference and think Riddle is back, Curtis Alexander is back, Sean Alexander is back,
tells me one thing, there won't be any tailbacks going to Alabama.
Boy, they got a stable of them, I'm telling you. They got a stable of them. The biggest thing is you look at the outgoing head coach and the incoming head coach at Alabama. What this means to Gene Stallings today is this will be his 70th win at Alabama. That's an average of 10 per year. Even the famed Bear Bryant did not average 10 victories a year. And that's got to be something that Gene will take with him as a very special thing.
Ronnie was probably just telling Mike DeBose, it's yours now. I'm not so sure he wanted to leave Alabama. He still wants to coach, but I'm not sure if he'll ever coach again.
Here's John Mark. I think he's just seen himself on television. ...17-6 with 2:15 left in our ballgame. To 5 yards deep, and they will not try to return it. So we'd like to thank the Blockbuster Blimp for providing us with these beautiful aerials today. It is currently flying over this event at an altitude of 1,000 feet. What a gorgeous, gorgeous day. It's been a great week down here in Tampa. These folks do a sensational job for the teams, for the schools, and I know both teams have had a great time.
Very well-run bowl game. And, Ron, Alabama did tonight or today what they've done all year. Played to their defense. Defense responded, then they won it with a running game. Possessions by that Michigan offense, and that's when the Alabama defense came up strong. Two field goals, and that's been the difference. You go back to Staten's play where he ran down Clarence Williams and just wouldn't allow them to get in the end zone.
You know, that play still may be as big a play as Rudd made with the interception and returning it. The play by Staten still may be the biggest thing that happened in this ballgame as far as maintaining momentum for Alabama. Gracie forced out of the pocket, back over the middle, and almost intercepted. And the clock will stop at 2:04. Sigler, the closest man to it.
This performance by Michael Myers today against Michigan's offense has been something short of spectacular, phenomenal. Michael Myers has been in the backfield for this Michigan offense the whole ballgame. 96, coming on an inside move. He forces Brian Greasy out to the left side, and then the hit on the outside by Kelvin Moore.
The near sideline, and again it's Woodson. Fernando Bryant will push him out of bounds, and that'll move the chains for Michigan. 2 minutes exactly left in this one. Mike gives me time with 2 minutes left. Want to thank this entire football family that together every Saturday night for prime time for just an outstanding job this season. Efforts of our production and our technical crew both here and up in Bristol have been wonderful, and they all do a great job and make it possible for us. Hard work, and it's also a passion that makes them the very best in the business, we think. We say congratulations, guys. It was a sensational year, and happy new year to you. Right on there, Joe Vanderbilt. So the clock stops 1:54.
32 people be ready. 32.
Michigan will go shotgun. Alabama rushes four. The pass incomplete. Tried to get it out to Clarence Williams.
Tough loss for Michigan here, Ron, because they had the ball game well in hand. They were ahead of field goal. They were dominating the football game. Then they had the interception, and that game just broke their back on that play.
And you know what Brian's got to be saying to himself. He is such a competitor, and you can never fault a kid for being a competitor. But just thinking, I was up in the air and let the ball go. If I had that one move to do over again, I would have eaten it, would have kicked the field goal, and you know, could have had a totally different result.
You're always trying to make plays, though. And the end result is Michigan didn't do a very good job of handling the blitz on third down by Alabama.
Greasy goes out of bounds at around the 43. With this Alabama football team, we have seen them now a number of times this year. And just as I said back in the third quarter, as Gene had said to the media, if you want us to be a pretty team and lose, and you got the wrong guy here. And they do win some ball games that, you know, they may not be pretty dancers, but they dance every dance.
Well, no, and there's some interesting statistics as far as comeback wins. I think they've had 30 comeback wins since 1990.
Gets it across. That's Shea, the tight end. Staten will bump him out of bounds. You see Staten trying to say, keep the clock running.
Ron, since 1990, they've had 24 comeback wins. So that means they're playing everything close to the defense. 13 comeback wins the last two seasons, make it 14 today with this win over Michigan. So they play a game where you're always going to be in the ball game, and you've got to win it in the fourth quarter on defense and special teams and running the football. And that's exactly the map they use today.
Sounds like an oversimplification, but you have to know how to win, and that's one of the things that they have done at Tuscaloosa for a long time. Deep over the middle, Clarence. George Williams wide open. It'll be first and goal. Michigan at the 9-yard line as Short made the tackle.
Ball thrown well again by Brian Williams. Brian Greasy got four wide receivers down the field. Andre Short versus the tailback Clarence Williams. Clarence Williams makes that catch, and Brian Greasy said, don't count this one in the bank just yet.
Clock whistled back in. 127, now 126. 41 yards in the pass play. Greasy gets it out in the flat. That's Shaw at the 5. He will score. All those people out in the parking lot, come on back.
Yeah, sometimes you can put the bats away too soon and put into the ball bag, and there's still 1:16 on the clock with a onside kick coming.
You see Mike DuBose wanting to call a timeout.
Yeah, he knows he's going to face a two-point play, so he wants to get the right personnel on the field.
So let's take a break. 1:16 left in our ball game. 17-12 and the two-point conversion to come. And Mike, all of a sudden, all those clean jerseys for Alabama are off the field. The regulars are back out there on defense.
Those dirty jerseys are back. Michigan's offense today, story of the game. Six possessions inside the 30, and they had to settle for those two field goals. Still alive, still breathing.
Two-point conversion coming here, and here comes the blitz, and Greasy's pass incomplete. And now here comes a late flag. Michael Fagan is the man who was covering on Russell Shaw. By the way, the day for Clarence Williams, 10 rushes, 55 yards, and Williams, 5 catches for 112.
The reason this is so big is if you get the onside kick, then all you have to work is to a field goal with the new rule of overtime. So now a little closer to try to get that two-point play.
So Michigan gets a second shot at it. And here comes the running play, and Floyd will take it in. 17-14.
Well, it's nervous stomach time now for both coaches because it comes down to one defined onside kick. With the touchdown, Brian Greasy with the throw. A good move on the outside by Russell Shaw. After making the catch, a little move on Michael Fagan in the end zone. Then the penalty on Alabama moved the ball a little closer. And Michigan sets up this onside kick.
The numbers on Greasy today. 21 of 37, 287 yards, one touchdown, and the interception by Dwayne Rudd, 88 yards, returned for a touchdown for the Crimson Tide.
Ron, he's played great. I think he's played very, very well on that side of the ball under the pressure that he was under today with the rush and blitzes of Alabama.
So the good hands team coming out here. We've got 1:16 showing on the clock. At the 42-yard line.
Remember, he had the problem on the catch on the punt that he
at the 1-yard line.
The ball on the 1-yard line, so he made up for it. Gene's going to hug him now.
Yeah, Gene, a little smile on his face. He did better that time, son.
There's the onside kick. It's exactly what you want. The big bounce. Chad Goss is sitting there and makes that catch and get out of the doghouse.
Boy, and Ty Street was right there getting ready to pounce on that thing. One timeout left for the Wolverines. Kitchens goes down maybe a half yard on the play. So timeout, the last one used by Michigan, will take it with them. 67 seconds left in this one. Well, we're back with 107 left to play as Michigan burned their final timeout of the ballgame. They trail by three, 17-14. Jared Irons, what a great career he has had up in Ann Arbor. Almost left, got homesick. He said much as anything, it was not his dad, it was his mom. As movement in the middle, and Carr jumps across, tries to recover the football before it was snapped.
Hey, Ron, he talked about that. He said his dad kind of agreed with him if he was homesick to maybe think about it, but his mom said, no, God's got a plan for your life, and it's in Michigan.
5 yards, Henry, take it down.
So he said, you know, mom is one of those that... You know, we don't stop anything with that we've started, so he decided to stick it out. It's obviously the best thing that could have happened to him. He's had a great career, has gotten his undergraduate degree, and is working sports marketing is what he got his degree in. Working on his master's now. Steele makes the tackle as he goes down, and now Michigan cannot stop this clock. It goes under 1 minute. The Stallings sitting high up. She's going to wave to us. I think she is probably more excited than any of them about getting to Paris, Texas, in that new home, which was completed last year.
The wives suffer going to ball games because there's not much they can do other than cheer up there. And great love for her husband, and suffers through every ball game, whether it's a win or loss.
John Mark waving. This win will be huge to him. Down on one knee, and that should be the final play of the 1997 Outback Bowl here in Tampa. 16 down to 15. Gene got a partial bath. And they're going to give him a walk-off. So that's the end of the ball game. Gene Stallings wins his 70th game as the head coach at the University of Alabama. Final score 17-14.
It's a great way to go out as a coach. A lot of coaches don't get to pick the way they want to go out. Gene Stallings did.
Dwayne Rudd has been named the player of the game in this one, and for obvious reasons on the interception and the 88-yard return, it stands as the largest play certainly for Alabama this afternoon in getting